and we are always praying. Our thoughts are prayers. Take care of what you're saying. In the higher consciousness, arise a peaceful rest, and know that God is always there. And every thought becomes a prayer. Our thoughts are prayers, and we are always praying. Our thoughts are prayers. Take charge of what you're saying. Seek a higher consciousness. Always a peaceful mess, and know that God is always there. And every thought becomes a prayer.
Acknowledging all people and all faiths symbolized by six candles. And the first candle is for the Tao, honoring the universal path of harmony and equilibrium, the natural way. The second light is the candle for Hinduism, honoring the path of knowledge, action, and devotion. Thank you. We light the candle for Judaism, honoring the ethical path of living by sacred law. Fourth, we light the candle for Buddhism, honoring the path of compassion. Fifth, we light the candle for Christianity, honoring the Christ consciousness as the path of love. Sixth, we light the candle for Islam, honoring the path of submission to the will of God. And finally, I invite you all just to take a moment and recognize the light within that is always shining as we honor the metaphysical path of wholeness, oneness, and mental healing through the practice of universal spiritual principles. Thank you. And the statement of truth for Carlsbad Center for Spiritual Living: there's a power for good in the universe, and you can use it. The mission statement for our center is to teach, demonstrate, and ensure a positive spiritual approach to living. So I'd like to give a warm welcome to any first-time visitors. I think I saw a couple. And invite you to sign our guest book, which is sitting on the table right outside the door there in the lobby, and join us for fellowship afterwards. Also, if anybody needs to update your email, you can do that at the table as well. And right now, it's a good time to shut off the cell phones if you haven't already. So a few announcements. I just want everybody to know, feel welcome. You don't have to ask somebody why they're wearing a mask. They're free to do that. In order to stay open, we're asking everyone to practice good self-care, stay aware, and be healthy. So just being together in the same room is wonderful. It's wonderful to see everybody in person. And and if you don't want to hug, no hugging. If you don't want to hold hands, you're free. So we're building our volunteer team, and today, just let you know, you can sign up out there to be a volunteer. I want to thank Pat for the flowers. Thank you, Pat. Wow. Want to thank Morgan, a greeter and a reader today, first time volunteer. Thank you, Morgan. And Larry with the hat for doing the recording. Thank you. And Reverend Dr. Amandra. Thank you for the meditation. And thank you, Jan, for the book table. Thank you. So, it would be great to help us spread the word that we're open. So invite a friend, invite a neighbor. And it's just a great way to get to know people and make friends. We're planning to start offering some classes. If you have some special topics you like, just let Reverend Kate know. We may be doing some classes right after the service, or we may do them online, Zoom, like say a Tuesday or Wednesday evening. So let us know what you like. Also, don't forget to take your car. I did that once. Don't leave your car here, because Reverend Kate locks the gate. Also, we have interfaith donations going to Reverend Amandra by the end of May, and I have a box out there for the North County Food Bank. So we're taking donations. So this is our time for our group reading. And if you have
So we're going to start with this song we've been doing for the last couple of weeks. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on spirit. Do you have the words for that by any chance? If not, it's very simple. It's woke up this morning with my mind stayed on spirit. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on spirit. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's the first verse. Second verse. Can't help, walking and talking with my mind stayed on spirit. Walking and talking with my mind. Guess what the next line is going to be? Walking and talking with my mind stayed on spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And then we go the first verse again. So it's, woke up this morning. If we can stand up, that's better for your vocal cords. Use that diaphragm, as a friend of mine, a lovely sweetheart, says all the time. Here we go. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on spirit. I woke up this morning with my mind never stayed on spirit. Second verse, I'm walking and talking with my mind stayed on spirit. I'm walking and talking with my mind stayed on spirit. I'm walking and talking with my mind, and it was stayed on spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. First verse, been talking with my mind stayed on spirit. I'm walking and talking with my mind, it was stayed on spirit. I'm walking and talking with my mind, and it was stayed on spirit. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Hallelujah, one more time, yeah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Woo, yeah, pretty good. Thank you. Thank you.
Woo. Wow, somebody's on fire. All right. Oh, back to our group reading. You want to stand or sit? Sit. Okay.
I think we're all sitting.
Okay.
Except a few of you.
In your program, let's say this together. God is all, both visible and invisible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect love and perfect abundance. I am the individual expression of God. I am the one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect abundance. Thank you. And next, we have the inspirational reading, Morgan McGregor.
This reading is by Vernon Shields, who is a divine science minister and author, and it's entitled Two Springs. There are two springs, one found with nature that comes once a year, the other of the heart that can be any time or eternal. In the spring of nature, we witness the transformation of the world about us. In the spring of the heart or of consciousness, we experience a renewal, a new zest for living, a new awareness of God's presence and power ever with us. We become transformed. The spring of nature takes place once each year. The spring of consciousness can take place any time or eternally. The eternal command is, "Behold, I make all things new." We need not wait for a certain time of the year to enjoy this renewal or spring of consciousness. When we decide, God is ready. As Shakespeare wrote, all things be ready if the mind be so. When we start, God starts. When we open ourselves to new life-giving, uplifting, beautifying ideas, our spring of consciousness begins. Why wait? Emerson wrote, "Within man, each one of us is the soul of the whole, the wise silence, the universal beauty to which each part and particle is equally related, the eternal one." Paul said that the inward man is renewed day by day. Let spring happen to you within, and the spring of nature will give to you great beauty, joy, and wonder. Today, the awareness of spirit springs forth. So it is.
We have another musical selection.
Wonderful, thank you. Thank you so much. This is my favorite, one of my favorite times of the year. I so love this season. It's so wonderful. This is one of my songs that I really like. I hope you enjoy as well.
Me up to my
like to introduce your minister, Reverend Kate.
It's so great to be back in person instead of talking to my computer, but I seem to have forgotten a few little things like how to turn microphones on and off. But it's wonderful, and happy Easter, everyone. I'm so glad to actually be in person on an Easter Sunday. It's a blessing. Thank you. So.
And you have a cute hat.
Do you like my hat? I'm hoping to win a prize. So here we are. You know, and no matter what's going on in the rest of the world or the rest of life, Easter is just a good day to take a break and recognize that there are things to be happy about and celebrate and have a little fun. But I want to get down to the important business of the day. So I have some very crucial questions for you. Where does the Easter Bunny get his eggs?
Mama!
I'm at an eggplant. What is the Easter Bunny's favorite sport? Basketball? Why did the Easter egg hide? He was a little chicken. And finally, why shouldn't you tell an Easter egg a joke? It might crack up. Okay. I mean, we all have different ideas and opinions about Easter and what we ought to be doing about Easter. Should Easter be about bunny rabbits? Or should it be about the resurrection? And that's why I like the reading that Morgan gave today, because it seemed to pull the two aspects together in a nice way. The renewal of our consciousness takes place in sync with the renewal of springtime. You know, the flowers are blooming everywhere, our hillsides are turning green, and then we have the joy of celebration and, you know, just knowing that children are out there looking for Easter eggs, and it's great. They go together. So do you remember when you were small? Didn't a chocolate bunny seem like so big back then? Or maybe Easter was a day when you might have gotten new clothes to wear. Maybe the first new clothes since the first day of school in the fall. All those little Easter outfits, you know, because my mom liked to dress me up. All those little Easter outfits, I don't really remember any of them, except for one. I remember the bright yellow dress that I spilled chocolate ice cream all over. I remember that perfectly well. And isn't it funny how some memories stand out and make an impression more than others? Like, for instance, my husband and I volunteered for 20 years at the Heritage Museum's pit barbecue. All those 20 barbecues. The one I always think of first is the day when it just poured rain. It rained and it rained. And we had a good time, but that's the one I always, you know, comes to mind. So what makes a day, what makes an event or a person memorable? That isn't always bad. Something going wrong. I mean, haven't you ever felt like the week you spent on vacation was so memorable compared to the week when you were just at home? You probably experienced that, or any special evening when you're with friends. If you think about what makes a certain memory memorable to you in your own life, do you think that that same principle would also apply to our shared memories, to the memories of our culture? You know, and really, if you just stop, today's Easter, well, why is so much of the world celebrating Easter this week? What was it about Jesus that impressed people so much back then that they would pass the stories along to us? So in our teaching here at the Center for Spiritual Living, we call our teaching New Thought. I'm sure you all know that. And we talk about how it's possible to change your life through changing your thoughts about life, which is true, and we're really all doing it all the time, whether we know it or not. And the spiritual practices that we teach are all about learning to use our thoughts more consciously, on purpose. But where did this idea come from? This idea that if you change your thinking, your life is going to change. You know, did the founder of our denomination, Ernest Holmes, think it up? He said he did not. He never claimed to take credit for the ideas. He referred to himself as someone who was seeking through the teachings of the world to find, you know, the nuggets of gold for us. Was it from Thomas Troward, who Ernest Holmes studied? He studied his writings. Troward wrote that the whole object of the Bible is to combat the idea of two opposing forces of the world, good and evil. He quoted the biblical words, "All things are of God," and that's what we teach. There's only a unity. And he also taught that thoughts are things, and we teach that. Or earlier, another New Thought teacher, Emma Curtis Hopkins, she said something else, and maybe she hit it, what do you call it, the nail on the head. She said that Jesus Christ taught that we may uplift our life by uplifting our thought. She said that Jesus Christ taught that the only uplifting thoughts are the thoughts of God, which she also called good, the thoughts of good. And she said that the true eternal thoughts of God or good were given to us by Jesus. So if she's right, and the true thoughts of God or good were given to us by Jesus in such a memorable way that people could actually grasp them, try to understand them, work with them, and pass them along through 100 generations. It's been that long. If she was right, then isn't it fair to say that the teachings of Jesus and the thoughts that he shared with the world back then have gradually, through all this time, bit by bit, been actually changing the thinking in the world itself? You could say that. And you could also perhaps say that our teaching, religious science or science of mind, is in a way a little like resurrecting some of the most basic of these teachings. And we try to understand these ideas without getting too caught up in the history, what was going on back in his day, what's going on in our day, kind of pulling them out. You know, I always like to recommend a red letter Bible and just focus on what he is reported to have said, but also to look at his teachings from a metaphysical standpoint, not try to take everything exactly word for word. I mean, it has been 2,000 years. I think it is the ideas of Jesus that really have changed the world to a certain degree. It's not about where he lived or when he lived. I mean, in reality, there have been over the millennium lots of people who have taught and lectured to big groups, probably way bigger groups. And unfortunately, a lot of people were put to death unjustly for things that didn't make any sense. And actually, I think it's possible that there are a lot of people who, after they died, were still able to communicate with the living some way or other. Maybe not like the stories of, you know, the resurrection and the ascension, but, you know, a feeling, perhaps. But despite all that, there was really something special about him and his words that ended up planting seeds into the shared consciousness of humanity itself. And those seeds, I believe, have continued to grow. So what made him and his teaching so memorable? I think it's partly just because he spoke in words that people could actually remember and understand. He used stories and parables that you could, you know, tell your children easily. And yet, hidden within these stories and parables, there was this deep truth. And the more you think, I mean, about really any of his parables, the more you think about it, the more that truth emerges for you. I know that one of the parables, for instance, the story of the prodigal son, it's very famous. It's well known about, you know, the son who goes off into the world and has a terrible time and finally comes back to home, realizing that home would be good. There's no place like home. So that's a story in my life that I've thought about, and as the years have gone by, mulling over it, I see it in new lights every time I think about it. You know, so I used to think about, oh, the son came to his senses. That was the important thing. But later I realized, for me, the important thing, sorry, was that Spirit was always there. Spirit was always running out to greet us. When we turn to Spirit, Spirit is ready to receive us. But back in the days of Jesus, when people believed in an eye for an eye, when people believed slavery was normal, when people believed in harsh punishment, back then, Jesus was teaching and demonstrating something revolutionary. Forgiveness, healing, friendship and generosity, faith, freedom, and just plain old loving kindness. You know, Jesus said, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open to you, for everyone who asks receives. It's a story of equality and freedom. Everyone who asks receives, the one who seeks finds, the one who knocks, to the one who knocks, the door will be open. It's available to all of us. And Jesus said, which of you, if your son asked for bread, would give him a stone? Or if he asked for a fish, would give him a snake. If you then are flawed in so many ways, if you know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more would your Father in heaven give good gifts, have good gifts for us? So with his parables and his instructions, he actually left the world a legacy of new thoughts. Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Love each other as I have loved you. And, of course, the kingdom of heaven is within. It's within each of us. So, you know, it's easy to look back through the fog of history and see that his era was very harsh and very cruel. And then look around today and say to yourself, oh, has it really changed? You know, the news is very troubling. There's a lot of bad news that's going on, and, you know, it doesn't take weeks and weeks for us to hear about it. It's almost instantaneous. But there is also good news. If we seek the good, we will find it. It's out there. So there's a ceasefire now in Yemen, and children who are starving are now able to get food. That is good news. A study was just completed that showed that during the hardest times of the COVID pandemic, people gave more generously than ever, despite the stories about hoarding toilet paper. I read that one particular nonprofit has preserved over 1 million acres of rainforest in just half a year. Wow. There is good news out there. It just doesn't get the big headlines. We have to seek for it. Because the reality is that there have been many, many changes in the world for better over the last 2,000 years. And I believe that most of these began with a thought, a new thought. Someone had the idea. And among those new thoughts are the teachings of Jesus, which you could say triggered a chain reaction about the nature of life and our place in it. So, you know, in the world of Christianity, there are many paths, right? So I like to say we follow the basic teachings of Jesus instead of the fundamental teachings of Jesus, because that word's already been taken. And I'm sure a lot of you grew up in more traditional churches. And then there are other people who call themselves modern Christians. And I just want to quote from one who was a scholar, and that was Episcopalian Bishop John Shelby Spung. And he wrote this. He wrote that the task of the modern Christian, and he would fall in that category, is to learn how to read the Easter story with an open heart, to have the living word that moves beneath the literal words of the Bible erupt, to call people into life and into the task of building an inclusive community where Christ is seen in all persons, where we can begin to respect the dignity of every human being, and where all people can begin to respond to the presence of God that is over, under, around, and through all of life. So a different way of saying a lot of the same things that we say. And you know, we lit the candles this morning in recognition to the many paths towards spiritual understanding. And I think that most of the people in this room, we're agreed upon the fact that we want to follow the path of love and the path of joy. and a path of faith in the eternal nature and the oneness of life itself. So our founder, Ernest Holmes, he wrote something similar to what Spong said, but also different. He wrote, "The spirit that raised Jesus dwells in all of us." And he wrote, now it is high time to awaken out of sleep. And he said, "The belief in a life apart from God, separate, is a dream from which we must awaken if we are to taste or experience the waters of reality which flow from the source of life. We need to wake up and be open to receiving." He said the world is saturated with divinity, immersed in reality, and filled with possibility. We must take this divine possibility and mold it into a present actuality in everyday experience. This is the way to freedom, the pathway to peace and happiness. And that's one of the things that I think brings us back to the basic teachings of Jesus. As you believe, it is done unto you. This is where we work with possibility thinking. And I think that's really the story of Easter for me, in a way. It's a day to celebrate the possibility of awakening, the possibility of rising up, the possibility of becoming conscious of the life we live, making choices, deciding what it is we want to seek, looking for the good, knowing what it is we wish to find, and having the faith to know that we can be persistent, we can be patient, looking for the good, knowing what it is we wish to find, and having the faith to know that we can be persistent, we can be patient, but we can also be faithful that what we seek, we will find. Our new thoughts do create new experiences, and in our own individual consciousness, it's true. And when we think thoughts in our own individual consciousness, this is the great thing. Maybe our thoughts aren't as powerful or earth-shattering as the words of Jesus, but as we think our thoughts, we too are spreading seeds out into the world of humanity. We are automatically radiating these ideas. They shine forth from us. Each of us actually matters. Each of us actually has thoughts that matter. And you know, that's the truth. That's this day. That's Easter. We're celebrating and we're ready to rise and shine, wake up and go. Spring has come again, and it is time for us all to rise up, to live life consciously. See the good underlying everything. We need to be in expression. So to seek and to find, that's my message for Easter. And I think we're ready to have a song. Turn it over.